Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another session of our Knowledge Club. So heartening to see so many of you here. Of course, it speaks highly of our guests who come also. There is a saying that the hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. And to prove that, just a small anecdote so that you know we loosen up the proceedings of the evening, which I read on the internet day before yesterday. It's about three men who wanted to cross a river, a torrent, you know, very difficult. So they pray to God, and the first man says, "God, give me the strength to cross the river." And poof, he gets strong arms, strong legs. And in about an hour or so, after almost drowning twice, he reaches the other end. Second guy prays to God, "Dear God, give me the strength and the means to get across." Poof, he gets strong arms, legs, and a boat, tries to get across. Boat flips over 2-3 times, half an hour, 45 minutes, he gets across. Third man says, "God, give me the common sense to get across." Poof, he becomes a woman. she takes a naksha map, just walks 500 yards up and crosses the river over a bridge. The hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. We've got a very interesting subject today. Nainalal Kidwai is going to speak to us about 30 women in power. A fascinating book, most readable. And not only that, I think we are really privileged that of this book, five of these women who've done so much in life are here with us this evening. Give them a big round of applause. When you go through the book and read the individual way that they have gone up in life, you will be surprised that there's a tremendous amount of hard work that has gone in. And they've achieved it on total hard work, sheer dint of hard work and merit. And besides that, they've had the will to win. No matter what, they're going to get on top. They've shattered glass ceilings. They've done all kinds of things, paved the way to show to the world what women can achieve in India. It's not been an easy journey. When you go through their biographies, you find all kinds of things mentioned in that. As I mentioned, a glass ceiling, social norms. We are a patriarchal society. Widows don't work. Among the ladies, I'll introduce to you one of them. Her father expired at the age of 8, leaving behind 4 girls. It was the mother who took up the cudgels, taught each one of them, made sure that they did well in life. And today she is sitting here with her Padma Shri. And I think it just goes to prove that society is changing, that the time has come when your and my girl child can achieve this much and reach the very top. I'll take a quick review of each one of them so that you know when they talk as to who is who. And I request you ladies, if you could just raise your hand a little so that people at the back can see who we're talking about. Nainalal Kidwai. She's the executive director on the board of HSBC Asia Pacific and chairman of HSBC India. Now hold your breath. She employs 32,000 people. She's non-executive director of Nestle, former president of FICCI, the first woman to achieve that post in 85 years, MBA from Harvard, and she's a Padma Shri. Sunita Nadayan, writer, environmentalist with the Center for Science and Environment since 1982. She is also a Padma Shri. She has achieved the World Water Prize for rainwater harvesting. Her grandfather was an eminent journalist. And as I mentioned, she's the one whose father passed away at the age of 8, when she was 8. Mother left with 4 daughters, who took up the cudgels, established the family's business, and gave the best education for her children, despite the fact that social norms dictated that widows do not work. Her motto in life, to do much more in life, to do anything less would be a disservice to my mother. Vinita Rai, 1968 batch IAS of the Union Territory Cadre, first woman to hold the post of Revenue Secretary in the Ministry of Finance. A tremendous achievement. 36 years in service, a great number of assignments, mother of 2 from Miranda House, and she's done an education at Brandeis University in the USA. Bharti Ramola Gupta. She's the India markets leader for PricewaterhouseCoopers, member India leadership team, on the board of 2 of the leading Indian firms promoting livelihood and development, and she was the financial advisor to the National Highway Authority of India for the Golden Quadrilateral Program. Devjani Ghosh, she's with Intel India and the first female director in South Asia, known for commitment to success, brought up to believe that she could achieve anything just as much as her brothers could. MBA in marketing from SP Jain Institute in Mumbai, and her passion in life, equal opportunities for all. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll now hand you over to Naina Lal Kidwai to conduct the proceedings.
Thank you all so much for being here today. I have to apologize for what is a terrible rasp in my voice. I lost my voice completely a little while ago. Luckily, it's back, and I'm here against doctor's instructions, but delighted to be here on what for me is a very important journey, and this is the journey of showcasing what India is about. And the inspiration for this book was really at a time way back in December 2012, when the Nirbhaya incident happened, and the depression and horrible feeling about being Indian. And then 2 weeks later, I took over as president of FICCI, and having to constantly explain to visiting dignitaries, CEOs of companies, presidents of countries, about the state of women in our country. And I think the reason is we have the horrible side of India, but we also have a terrific side which we don't tell enough. And when I began to do a little test check of companies which have women CEOs as heads, or indeed some of the names that are in the book, very few people even in the world of business knew everyone. And you will see today, and this is, as you see, a universe of 4 out of 30, the terrific women we have leading terrific companies. And the one criteria I had was they should have been leading businesses or leading people. So Vinita led people in the IAS, Sunita leads people in the not-for-profit sector. So these were the 2 outside of the world of business, and the rest are pretty much in the world of business, to give you a mix therein. I'm going to start by really highlighting what I've summarized actually in the first chapter of the book, which is what are the keys to success? And there are common threads that have come here, and I'm going to ask each of the panelists to comment on which ones they think are important and to bring some of these points to life. So clearly, there are no shortcuts to hard work. That's a common theme. Each one of them pretty much says they had to work harder than men at their organizations in order to achieve what the men achieved. So I suppose that's a subtle form of recognition of discrimination, but no shortcuts to hard work. Then integrity. This whole thing about integrity comes through very strongly in terms of the qualities these women have embraced as very close to them. Humility. And the fact that humility is indeed a hallmark of success. So again, a common thread through this. And some of them talk about how they have to keep reminding themselves about bringing back humility in the way they work. Ambition. And in fact, you would think ambition may be a bad thing, but the fact that ambition is not necessarily bad and how that becomes a driver for success. And last but not least, that passion to succeed, passion to excel, passion for what they do as a driver. So these are broad but very common themes across all the essays. And I'm now going to turn to each of the panelists, and you know, maybe we can start with Devjani, and to comment on some of these areas and how you see them, and if you wanted to order them in terms of importance as well.
You know, I was born to a father with crazy ambitions and all for me. He was, from the day I was born, he was pretty much convinced that whatever I would do, I would be the best at. So I have grown up, and his interests, and based on as I grew up, as I started speaking, as I started showing mannerisms, every day he would discover something new about me. Oh, she can argue really well. She can do this really well. So his ideas or aspirations towards what he wanted me to become would change daily. So I've grown up hearing, I can be the best lawyer in the world, I can be the best doctor in the world, I can be the best prime minister in the world, you know. I've grown up hearing that. And to me, it did two things. One is, I have never ever apologized for my ambition, never. To me, I've always aspired to be something that is beyond the normal reach. And I've never felt bad about aspiring for that. I've never felt that I'm being a bad woman or being a bad person because it's how I grew up. And then the second thing was, whatever I do, I have to be the best at. It was pretty much ingrained there. Not just have to be the best at, but I can. And that's what Dad would keep saying, you can. You have everything that your brothers have. There's nothing that you don't have. In fact, you might have a little bit more. So you can be the best. And I think, you know, Naina, everything you read out there is so important. In terms of criteria for success, I think the role parents play, I would just put on top of that, because if my father didn't believe in me the way he believed in me, I doubt very much I would be sitting here and talking to any of you. That just changed my person, that molded my personality. And in terms, you know, everything else, I think the ambition is a must. We apologize too much for being ambitious. It's not a bad word. It's needed. It's needed for success. And then the hard work, the integrity, the humility, all of that has to be in place. So
for all the fathers out there, the influence of the parents, but also of the father, is paramount. And you will hear that as a common theme, again, through many of these essays.
So I can certainly, you know, agree with Devjani that it was Papa who really determined that I was going to be independent. I was going to be independent financially, economically, and emotionally. And then he did everything possible to help me to do that. So yes, absolutely. I think the role of our father is really, really critical in our lives. The role of my mother, actually, I didn't realize until I became a mother myself. So I think we take our mothers for granted, and only when you become a mother yourself, then you think back on all the nights and, you know, all the hard work that she put in. So yes, our parents are really, really critical. I think among all the things that Naina talked about, and I want to talk a little bit about ambition, and I want to talk about humility. You know, I didn't think of myself as very ambitious when I started out. I just wanted to do everything I did, do it really well. And for a long time, I thought that if that's what I did, the fruits of my hard work would follow. And I think somewhere along the way, I began to realize that that's not enough. I need to raise my hand and tell people what I want next. Because, you know, the men do it all the time. And if, as a woman, you don't, then as it is, there are a lot of them who will not notice that you are sort of there. But if you also don't tell them you're interested, they just think you're good at what you're doing. But, you know, it's too much to expect you to do anything more. So if, you know, for the younger women in the room, you know, if you really want to be able to do more, you have to actually say that you want to do more. And then that really then takes you forward. Humility, again, I don't think I had it when I was growing up, because I grew up reading, and my heroes were writers and artists and, you know, people who are individually excellent. And so when you read their stories, you read the stories of these individually excellent people, you know, they're not necessarily the nicest people. They can be, you know, they sort of can be badly behaved. They can certainly be have moods. And you say, well, you know, I mean, it's okay for somebody like a Van Gogh to be what he was, because what a brilliant artist, you know. So when you have that sense of what excellence is, you don't quite fathom what it means to be in a different sphere, which is where I was, where I'm supposed to be a leader. You know, it took me a long time to figure out that I may not mean it, but I was seen as arrogant just because I thought I was bright. And it's something I had to work on if I had to lead people. You know, it's not good enough to know how to do